Hello friends, welcome to Healthwizac, Medical Concepts Simplified. In this video, we will learn about Acute Coronary Syndrome or ACS and ST Elevation MI. ACS or Acute Coronary Syndrome is a clinical condition arising due to sudden onset, inadequate supply of blood and oxygen to the cardiac tissue. The major cause of ACS revolves around either blockage of coronary artery or mismatch in the myocardial demand and supply. Coronary atherosclerosis remains the major cause for this. Atherosclerosis reduces the inner lumen, causing stenosis and thus leading to hypoperfusion state. It triggers plaque formation, which is constantly exposed to blood flow, leading to the erosion of fibrous cap. As the plaque is ruptured, thromboxane A2 is released along with the conformational changes in glycoprotein 2B3A receptor, and thus platelet starts aggregating and coagulation occurs, leading to thrombus formation. This thrombus gets dislodged and gets stuck in the coronary arteries, where the site and extent of thrombosis may result in either hypokinesia, akinesia, or even dyskinesia of the regional area of the heart, thus hampering the cardiac contractility. Stenosis of 50% can present symptoms on exertion, whereas a stenosis of 80% or more can have symptoms at minimal exertion or even at rest. The factors governing the demand and supply mismatch includes myocardial contractility, myocardial wall tension, pulmonary function, hemoglobin level, coronary blood flow, and other comorbidities. Apart from coronary atherosclerosis, coronary spasm as in Prinzmetal angina, ostial narrowing, and even hypercoagulable state as in diabetes can also precipitate the event. ACS or acute coronary syndrome is primarily categorized into two types, that is ST elevation ACS, also labeled as STEMI or ST elevation MI, and non-ST elevation ACS. STEMI or ST elevation ACS occurs due to complete transmural infarction or blocking of the coronary arteries, whereas non-ST elevation ACS occurs due to non-transmural subendocardial infarction, where NST ACS is further categorized into non-ST elevation MI and unstable angina, whereas myocardial infarction or MI is further categorized into five types, which are as follows. Type 1 is where MI occurs due to atherosclerotic plaque rupture. Type 2 is where MI occurs due to inadequate perfusion. Type 3 is where MI occurs due to sudden unexpected cardiac death. Type 4A is MI related to percutaneous coronary interventions. Type 4B is MI related to stent thrombosis. And type 5 is MI related to coronary artery bypass graft operations or surgeries. The risk factors associated with acute coronary syndrome include hypertension, diabetes mellitus, dyslipidemia, obesity, alcohol and smoking, family history, age, postmenopausal state, and sedentary lifestyle. Coming to symptoms of acute coronary syndrome, patient usually presents with chest pain radiating to left hand, back, shoulder, neck, and even jaw. Patient usually describes pain as heavy, squeezing, and crushing in nature, which is not relieved with rest, along with discomfort and uneasiness. Other symptoms that patient usually complain are diaphoresis, sweating, breathlessness, palpitation, nausea, dizziness, and even confusional state. The diagnosis of ACS primarily starts with symptoms along with history and physical examination, which may reveal hypotension, tachycardia, lung crepitation on auscultation, orthopnea, and edema feet. Next step is to get a 12-lead ECG done as early as possible. ECG may show STT changes in the form of either ST elevation or ST depression along with rhythm abnormalities, but sometimes it may be normal. Patient with ST segment elevation of at least 2 mm in two contiguous precordial leads and 1 mm in two adjacent limb leads are considered as candidate for reperfusion therapy. Here, an important point should be noted that a new onset LBBB or left bundle branch block along with symptoms of ACS should be treated aggressively like ACS, as LVBP may mask STT elevation or depression. But the final call should be taken up by the treating cardiologist, who may confirm the diagnosis along with cardiac markers, 2D echo, and even coronary angiography. Next important diagnostic tool is troponin eye level, which may be detected as early as 3 hours from the onset of event and may be detected up to 2 weeks post myocardial injury. ACS is confirmed if the result of troponin eye level is more than 99th percentile of the test value. Along with this, CPK-MB is also found elevated. Next important diagnostic tool is 2D echo or echocardiography, which may show regional wall motion abnormalities along with hypokinetic or akinetic regional wall movements with compromised or preserved ejection fraction. Other diagnostic tools include cardiac radionuclide imagings, but they lack specificity to acute versus chronic infarction. Apart from this, high resolution cardiac MRIs are also available, which may be sensitive, but they may prove costly. Hence, they are used by the cardiologist in special conditions if required. Next diagnostic tool is coronary angiography or CAG, which proves to be the ultimate test in diagnosing ACS, as it gives us the location and extent of block through TIMI grading system, where TIMI stands for thrombolysis in myocardial infarction. In TIMI grading system, the extent of block can be described as following scale, where grade 0 is complete occlusion of the insulted artery, grade 1 is where there is some penetration of contrast but without perfusion of distal coronary bed, grade 2 is where there is perfusion of entire infarction vessel up to the distal bed but with a delayed flow, and finally grade 3 where there is full perfusion with normal flow. Other supporting investigations may be CBC, where it may show polymorphonuclear leukocytosis, LFT, RFT, sugar levels, urine examination, arterial blood gas levels, and X-ray, where all these may help in giving some insights about the other comorbid conditions. Based upon the clinical presentation, ECG findings, and troponin eye level, patient can be diagnosed having one of the three variants of ACS, that is, first, ST elevation MI, where clinical presentation is in favor of ACS, ECG shows ST elevation and troponin I level is positive. Second is non-ST elevation MI, where clinical presentation is in favor of ACS, ECG shows ST depression and troponin I level is positive. And third is unstable angina, where the clinical presentation is in favor of ACS, but ECG may show STT changes or sometimes it may be normal, and the troponin I level is negative. A very important point should be noted here that sometimes patient arrives too early with positive signs and symptoms of ACS, and ECG and troponin I level may come normal. In these circumstances, if possible, the diagnosis should be confirmed with either 2D echo or coronary angiography, or patient should be admitted and serial ECG should be done and troponin I level should be repeated after 3 hours. If in any condition above diagnostic tools are pointing towards STEMI, then STEMI protocol should be followed at the earliest. After diagnosing ACS or specifically ST elevation MI, now let's have a look at the management of STEMI, where the ultimate goal is to reduce the time between the first medical contact and initiation of reperfusion therapy. As soon as the patient is diagnosed having STEMI, early IV access should be taken along with the monitoring of cardiac rhythm and SpO2 levels. Patients should be started on monatherapy as early as possible, where M stands for morphine, which is used to relieve pain. Whereas, if morphine is not available, other pain-relieving agents can also be used. O stands for oxygen, which is used if SpO2 level is less than 90% and patient is having breathlessness. N stands for nitrates, which helps in vasodilation and augments blood flow, but it should be avoided if BP is less than 90/60 mmHg or patient is having history of using sildenafil. And A stands for aspirin, which is given in a dose of 325 mg, which has antiplatelet action and prevents thrombosis through COX-1 and thromboxane A2 inhibition. along with monotherapy. Other agents that are used in acute scenario include statins, that is specifically atorvastatin in a dose of 80 mg, which helps in plaque stabilization, P2Y12 receptor antagonist category of drugs, which includes clopidogrel in a dose of 300 mg stat, or ticagrelor in a dose of 180 mg stat, or prasugrel in a dose of 60 mg stat. Next is beta blockers, which helps in reducing myocardial oxygen demand, but they should be avoided in conditions like post-MI acute heart failure, bradycardia, hypotension, heart block, and asthma. And finally, anticoagulants category of drugs, that is low molecular weight heparins, which avoids the risk of thrombosis. But before starting them, patients should be checked for history of bleeding. After the initial management of STEMI, patients should be taken for early coronary angiography to locate the extent and location of block, and should be taken for definitive treatment step, that is reperfusion therapy, which includes percutaneous coronary intervention, that is percutaneous coronary angioplasty, or CABG, that is coronary artery bypass graft, depending upon which is suitable for patient, where outcome is very good if door to needle time is less than 90 minutes, but can be done within 12 hours depending upon the signs and symptoms of the patient. However, if provision for coronary angiography or PTCA or CABG is not available, patient can be given option for fibrinolysis, especially in ST elevation MI. Or best, he or she should be shifted to tertiary care center with cath lab facility in a cardiac ambulance. For fibrinolysis, drugs like tenecteplase is used, which comes under the category of recombinant tissue plasminogen activator. Apart from this, other agents like altiplase, retiplase, or even streptokinase are also used. If in any condition fibrinolytic therapy fails, or patient is having persistent chest pain, or ST elevation is persistent even after 90 minutes of fibrinolysis therapy, then patient should be shifted to higher center with cath lab facility, and CAG should be done at the earliest. And depending upon the CAG report, PTCA or CABG should be considered at the earliest. Before taking decision for fibrinolysis, one important point should be noted that there are some definitive contraindications to fibrinolysis therapy, which include history of cerebrovascular accident within 1 year, BP more than 180 by 100 mm of mercury, aortic dissection, internal bleeding, INR more than 2, history of recent surgery, history of CPR resuscitation, pregnancy, active peptic ulcer, severe hypertension, or known allergy to the molecule. Before concluding this topic, let's have a look at some of the important scoring system that gives us valuable insights about our approach and management for patients with STEMI or ACS. TIMI Risk Score for STEMI, which calculates 30 days mortality rate in patients with STEMI. It is calculated on the basis of 8 factors, which includes age, systolic blood pressure, heart rate, clip class, anterior ST elevation or LBBB, diabetes, history of hypertension or angina, weight, and time to treatment. Each factors are assigned points, which gives us a minimum score of 0 and a maximum score of 14, where a score of 0 interprets the 30-day mortality rate to 0.8%, whereas a score of more than 8 interprets the 30-day mortality rate to 35.9%. So friends, this brings us to the end of this topic. Hope you find this information valuable and applicable in your clinical practice. Please do like and share this video and hit the bell icon for latest updates. And for more such informational videos on medical topics, please subscribe to YouTube channel Healthwizac, Medical Concepts Simplified. Thank you.